The Passing Scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.
Welcome to the monthly BC TV program titled The Passing Scene, News and Views. I'm your host, George M. Meiser IX, President Emeritus of the Historical Society of Berks County and co-compiler of the Passing Scene series of illustrated Reading and Berks histories. Appearing with me on the set today is co-host Tad Kelby-Kastner, president of the Center Park Historic District. Beside Tad are Ann Wagner and Les Rohrbach. The latter is president of the Berks County Association for Graveyard Preservation. Ann is vice president. Ann and Les appear this evening to make viewers more keenly aware of the work their organization does.
Our friend Larry Soltis of Exeter Township reminds us to inform home viewers that this program will repeat this Sunday, August 11th at 10 p.m., Monday, August 12th at 9 a.m., and next Wednesday, August 14th at 3 p.m. Let me repeat those times once more. The show will repeat this Sunday, August 11th at 10 p.m., Monday, August 12th at 9 a.m., and next Wednesday, August 14th at 3 p.m. We're pleased to have Les Rohrbach and Ann Wagner with us to share photos of their important work. Were it not for the Berks County Association for Graveyard Preservation, the historic family burial grounds of Berks County would pass into history and soon be forgotten. A significant number have already disappeared. Today's program is presented with the hopes that some home viewers might be induced to join the group and get involved in some way.
Or in the least, join.
There we go.
Should we start? We may have the, there we are. Do you want to take over and just comment on?
Okay, well that's just our mailing addresses, Post Office Box 3707, Reading, 19606. And we're kind of proud of our new logo. Last year we had a logo contest with some kids with Votech, and that was our chosen new logo. So
that's impressive.
Yeah.
It's very impressive.
The student got $175, I believe it was.
Good. I was personally interested in this Hemmig Cemetery. I remember Ray Kebach talking about it years ago. And I always wanted to get over there and look around. And that was 40 years ago, and I still haven't gotten over there yet, but I'm working on it. Tell us about this stone, Les.
Well, that's about the only thing that's there, unfortunately, at this point. We've had residents who live in the area tell us that there may be tombstones that were thrown back in one corner and are sort of underground now. We haven't really tried excavating to look for them. It's sort of interesting too that what we have here is the Hemmig family, and it's really, I think, the Kurtz family and, I don't know, Koenig who settled there. I'm not really sure I know where the Hemmigs came into this, but they weren't the early settlers.
Now, you know, Hemmig's Mill was along Lancaster Avenue, where that emergency pet hospital is. Mm-hmm. If you would tear off that false facade, that lower green, like plastic or whatever that is, you'd see brownstone, and that was the Hemmig Mill was there. And the Kurtzes go way, way back in that mm-hmm. general area. Remember the Kurtz house years ago? There where Penn Supreme stood later, and now there's a gas station at Morgantown. It's what?
At New Holland.
New Holland Road and Lancaster Avenue. Yeah, that was where the Kurtz, the old Kurtz farmhouse is still there. Right there at that intersection. It's a brick building near that where the train crosses over. That says what? Hemmig Cemetery, Johannes Hemmig, 1742-1820, from Zizziffe in Switzerland in 1750 with parents Hans and Eva. Elizabeth Hemmig, 1749-1804, and Barbara Hushauer, 1779, 1846, and others.
So now, oddly enough, the people that are mentioned on that stone, we found that their stones are at a local cemetery, a big cemetery there, but we don't have any evidence to say that they were exhumed. So we believe that at some point the family decided to protect the stones and move them. Now, Kurt's family members, we know that there were some exhumations, and several of them are at the House of Good Shepherd, and there's good records on that.
So the House of Good Shepherd?
Yeah, the one down at Tuckerton.
Good Shepherds.
Yeah, the Good Shepherd Cemetery.
Hinnerschitz's cemetery.
Used to be Hinnerschitz, yeah. And we have records, so we know that they were moved.
Hmm.
Next.
Mm-hmm. The Hemmig Kurtz cleanup.
Yeah, we went out and did a cleanup. We had several cleanups, actually. And we had good crews at all of them, and it was a lot of heavy brush. And the town, the borough, didn't realize it was even there anymore. I mean, I'm sure somebody did at some point, but those that were there now. And the borough manager, Brian Cole, was kind enough to work with us and take care of the shrub removal, you know, all the brush that we piled up.
I mean, we cut it and cleaned things up, but at least they took it out of there. There was a neighbor who, the first time we were there, we had about 12 giant garbage bags, trash bags filled with debris, and he said he'd take it for us. So we just
that was good of him.
Got rid of it that way.
Yeah. Okay, that's out of place. But that is Keith working on the Hoke Cemetery in Richmond
out of
Township.
Place.
Right outside of Fleetwood.
I don't think I was. We're outside of Fleetwood. Is it on the road leading?
662.
Okay.
Right next to Willow Creek.
Okay.
Right, just a little beyond the Grange.
Okay, I know where that is.
And you
there used to be a log cabin in there one time
across
across the street. It was a log cabin. That was there until about maybe 20 years ago.
Yeah, I mean, you know, one of the interesting or disappointing things maybe that we run into frequently is the fact that once a family moves away from their graveyard, the descendants pretty quickly don't know about it. And we had one of our members asked us to go work there, and he went to, and once we did get it cleaned up, you'll see some photos later on of what it looked like when we first got there.
Right.
But he went to, there's a Hoke Family Association, and he knew when they were having their meeting one year, he went to that, and a lot of the members are from Fleetwood, right?
Yeah.
And he, you know, they asked for contributions to help us restore the graveyard, and they had a lot of people there who said, what graveyard? Where is it? Can you show it to us? You know, and it's right in their backyard. So that, and that's not unusual for us to run into that.
I talked to the Hoke Family Association at that the back part of the gas station there at the light at Maiden Creek, or what used to be called Halfway House. There's a gas station on the corner, and there's like a room downstairs in the back. But and the Hokes had their reunion there, and I spoke to them maybe 25 years ago or so.
Okay, so now we're back to the Hemmig. that was just another one of the work days.
A good-sized group went out two different days to get the worst of the brush and trash that had been accumulating. We searched for signs of wall edges and any sign of tombstones.
See, it's really technically two graveyards. Right. They sort of back up to one another, and the property line provides the boundary.
So the first day we went out there, we made up packets for all the neighbors, and I went knocking door to door to see who could give us more information about it, because we needed to find out where the boundary lines were and if anybody knew what happened to the tombstones, you know, basic information. And we did find someone who was there back in like 1950, and she did provide a lot of information. But till it was all said and done then, Kenhurst Burroughs engineer donated their services to do a survey of the site to mark the boundary lines. And there's some more.
Gathering
that's Ed Gensmer, who's the president of Allenbox, is also one of our members, and Laura Thompson, Thomas, who is our brand new secretary, bagging up some stuff. And is that Gary Koenig on the other slide? He actually is a family member. He is. We believe that his Samuel Koenig, like six generations back, is buried there. And he's been a big help.
Yeah, I mean, that's one way we get people to come out if they see that we're working, you know, if they are paying attention and know a little bit about their ancestry and they see we're working someplace, we'll see them for the first time because they want to see their,
they're curious.
Their family grave.
Sure they are. We uncovered broken bottoms at two tombstones slightly below ground level.
Right. So we don't know what happened to the tops. We didn't uncover the tops. We did some probing, but I mean, the first few days we were in there, we were basically there to clean up. We didn't get to do a lot of looking around.
Raymond Keebach was there. You have copies of his notes, don't you?
Yes.
Yeah, Raymond Keebach.
Yep.
Raymond and I were buddies years back. He talked about that cemetery.
Well, we believe there's should be about 30 people that were buried
really?
In
there. Really? Mm-hmm. Next.
And there's a view of it from the playground side. We let a log go across there because that people were driving through it. They actually thought it was the straight alley.
Really? But I can see that looking at that picture.
Yeah, but the alley actually is supposed to curve around it, around the graveyard.
So it takes a left turn and then a right turn and goes parallel to the graveyard. And then when it gets to the end of it, the alley takes another right turn to come back to sort of finish the straight line through.
So instead of just being a, you know, drive straight through alley, it's a
so there's a playground
roundabout.
There.
There's a playground on this side.
To the right.
To the right, yeah. And then on the other side is the Russian-Greek cemetery.
Russian Orthodox Greek Catholic Cemetery.
Okay, okay.
So we put up some signs. I had some signs made up. Basically, just giving a little bit of information on the cemetery, and I put, you know, one at each end so that people know this is the cemetery.
It'd be interesting to know if those signs are still there.
That's
like
what I was wondering.
2 months after we were
I was wondering.
Born.
Right.
I'm going to have to get over there and take a look. I'm curious.
So there's the hoax.
That's when we first were there. To the right of the guy on the left, you can sort of see the iron gate going into it.
Oh, I see it, yeah.
This is my absolute favorite picture because David and Keith are like, oh, wow. You just can't.
The Amazon.
I should have got the pictures of their faces, but you know, Keith's trying to peek through to see what he can see. But that's what it looked like when we first got on the scene.
Wow.
David, he's just trying to figure out, what are we going to do with this? David Schlegel takes care of probably a dozen old family burial grounds
really?
For us. Yeah, he's amazing.
Good soul.
He's a Fleetwood resident and many graveyards in surrounding his locality. I don't think she has a picture of this, but the graveyard today is like a lawn.
Really?
Mm-hmm. I mean, he must use a lawnmower to cut it.
I drove by the Esterly Cemetery along Oley Turnpike. My. But you know what? With all the rain we've had and with the heat,
it's hard to keep up with that.
Once cleared and inside, we found badly crumbling walls. This How many burials were on that cemetery? Do you have an idea?
20, maybe?
I don't know. Maybe that.
Is your cemetery book still for sale?
No. That's out of print. We found a lot of mistakes in that as we went.
It's a little editing.
Yeah, we decided it wasn't going to get reprinted till we made some corrections. And there was a lot of things that, you know, they couldn't see these things because we didn't have D2 back then.
Yeah, right. That's
now
true.
We know we can clean these tombstones that you can read them.
Yeah.
When they couldn't before. They were taking guesses at a lot of it.
But remember I told you I have, 100 pictures that I took about 1965 of the private cemeteries. Largely Oley, I think I have every cemetery of Oley, the private cemeteries, but I have other ones as well in Ruscoe Manor. I remember behind the Evangelical Church in Pricetown, I had a crawl in my belly to read those stones because it was so overgrown.
Mm-hmm. Oh, gee.
Yeah. I crawled better that time than I do today.
Yeah, I'm sure.
Yeah.
That's interesting.
So they're not laying down like that anymore. You know, they're somewhat stood up now. But that's kind of what we were looking at when we got there, once we got through all those weeds mm-hmm. and trees. And
The walls were very deteriorated.
I didn't see that.
But you can see in the background, you do get to see some lovely scenery when you're mm-hmm. out.
One of these days I want to get to St. Henry's. That's another one of the places that mm-hmm. I'm on my bucket list.
Mm. Well, we're working there. We expect to be there this fall.
Yeah.
I'm going to make it a point to get there this fall. St. Henry's of Massillon.
Yeah, St. Yep. Henry's is interesting because it's actually... The Allentown Diocese is actually responsible for that, but they don't really do a very good job there.
How shocking.
And the family that has the greenhouses there are kind enough to let us go in there through their property because it's much easier than going in through the person that owns the property it's actually sitting on.
Yeah.
And they're very nice. So when we go there, we buy produce from them and, you know, whatever
nice.
They're selling.
Nice. There's no sign of a wall there, but ever.
Now, Keith has it ripped down. That's while Keith was working on that wall.
Is that? Oh, okay.
This is the Hoke graveyard.
This is still the Hoke.
Get chunked.
And there, that's finished.
Amazing.
So.
He had a lot of trouble, more difficulty with those walls because the stones that were used weren't squared off. There were all sorts of
rubble zone.
And they had cemented the outside and the inside to try to hold things together. And when he tore it apart, you know, it just crumbled. We had to get extra stone. And a wall like that
That's a big area to cover.
Yeah, it's quite a long wall too.
That was, a $15,000 wall?
I think something like
about
that.
About $15,000.
Or $20,000.
Really?
Yeah. People don't realize how much work it is to do these old ones. And you can't, you know, when they're digging around there to do the wall, it's no big equipment. It has to be hand dug.
Oh, yeah.
Because you don't want to take any chance that you're digging into graves.
Mm-hmm.
We found that, you know, there's often burials outside the walls.
Really?
So we sure don't want to take somebody in there with big equipment.
Remember the private cemetery?
Oh, sure.
Really?
Yeah, yeah. And that's the second wall.
Is that the public road there off in the background?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that would be 662.
662.
Right. So that was when Keith started the second wall.
Wow.
And there he is.
There he is, taking a break.
That's a lot of work.
That is a lot of work. Keith does beautiful walls.
Yeah, they are lovely.
The old-fashioned way, and you just can't imagine how he puts those together.
Mm-hmm.
And that's an example of D2.
That's astounding. That is astounding.
It is. It is. And that's without scrubbing, because there's old marble stones, you're better off not scrubbing.
Oh, yeah,
because every
time
you take something over
they powder the...
A little more sugaring,
yeah.
They call it sugaring, comes off. And we spray it with D2 and just walk away.
Here rests who? Jacob S.C.H. Shaw.
Shaw, Jacob Shaw. That was revolutionary, right?
1774 to 1851.
Yeah. Well, if that's it, it would have been 1812.
Yeah, right.
I'm not
with
sure
those
which...
dates.
That's right, impressive how that cleans the stone.
Yep. Sometimes it takes a couple sprays. You know, you go back a month later and spray it again.
Oh, is that what you do?
And then usually by the third time you've given it a coat, it's pretty white.
Oh, neat. Then you depend on the rain to clear it off?
Yeah.
Really? Yeah. That's impressive, too.
Okay, that is Annie Hoke. That's my favorite stone in the Hoke Cemetery.
And if you go to the next slide, it tells her Annie's
story.
Oh,
that's the one where she was...
Right.
She burned at school. Stony Lane School. Reading Eagle, April the 1st, 1882, Miss Annie Hoke, who was severely burned at the Stony Lane School, died this morning from the effects of her injuries. I can imagine what a horrible death that was. Annie was a bright young girl, regular in her studies. She had been absent but 3 days in the term, and on the last day, volunteered to take out the ashes. Among them were some hot cinders, which the wind blew against her clothing and set it on fire. Soon she was entirely in flames, and but for the heroism of her teacher, Thomas Fretz, she would have been burned to death. He himself was painfully burned about his hands and arms. After a week's suffering, death ensued. The incident is much deplored. Wow.
So this is kind of the interesting part when we go in there and...
add substance to what you're doing.
Yeah, we'll find a tombstone that catches somebody's fancy, and then we'll do some digging and we'll find out something about them.
The Reber Cemetery. Where's the Reber Cemetery?
You do this one.
Outside of Burnville.
the Rebers are over in Burnville, okay.
Irish Creek Road.
There's Shortlesville Road coming out of Burnville, and a mile out there is Irish Creek Road off to the right, and it's maybe a mile out Irish Creek Road. This is, again, we're in the state here where we have a woman member who is the granddaughter of the last owner of this, a Reber. So she still knows about it, and so the family has been involved with maintaining this site generally pretty much continually. Now, they came to us last fall because they hadn't been able to do the outside work, and you see in the back there's two cedar trees that had branches down to the ground, all over the walls. There were vines growing up, and it was more than, I guess, the fairly elderly people who were caring for it could handle. So we were in there last fall and cleaned the back out. Well, we found that the walls are very deteriorated, and they had looked into having a stonemason years ago come in and do something, but it had been too expensive for them. We have began the rear wall is torn down. A lot of times when we do repairs a wall at a time, and if we can, we jump around to different cemeteries so we're not working at one place for an entire year or something. But we are, so right now we have in process the rear wall and a portion of the left wall, which comes to the gate. They're being torn down and rebuilt. Again, the stone in this wall is not real good. We're going to have to purchase additional stone to be able to rebuild it. And we're hoping to do more walls a little later. The family has been very forthcoming in providing funds for this. So that, again, is another reason to come back. There's probably only one other graveyard that where we've gotten contributions. Well, at that other graveyard, we got well in excess of what they've given us. But still, what they're doing is far in excess of the remainder of the graveyards where we work. So, we try to reward the people who are helping us out.
Oh, absolutely.
Too. Right.
Absolutely.
It's kind of like voting with your money. Voting where
right.
We're going to go next. You know, what cemetery will we work on next?
Just look at that.
And that's just showing how bad the walls are. And we knew the back really needed to get done because there's tombstones all along the back. And we didn't want that wall collapsing in and destroying something that we can't fix.
That is a bright Brecht graveyard in... Jefferson Township.
That's along the Burnville, what, Robazonia Road?
It's going out, no, it's out of Burnville. Graveyard is over on that side of the property.
Was the Bride School the brick building that they tore down when they were working on Blue Marsh?
I don't think so.
I wouldn't know.
There was a Bride.
It was on the other side of the road.
When you're heading to Burnville, is Bride's Road on the right-hand side going up a little hill?
On the yes. right-hand side,
well,
yeah.
At the top of that hill on the left, right at the top of the hill on the left was a brick schoolhouse. And that was Bride's School.
Okay.
I remember taking pictures of that. In the 60s.
Well, a few years back, the Bright Brick Family Association came to us, and Nancy and Ed Grazik are real active with them, and they fundraised with their group, and then we ponied up the rest, and we put up a nice iron fence.
Where'd you get the iron fence?
That was a Bachman fence.
Really?
Bachman Ironworks.
Really?
Yeah, it's not. It's an iron fence, yeah. And that's what the family asked for.
Right.
And the old port in a storm. It's better than nothing.
The graveyard had been overrun. There was a tree in the middle of it.
The
tree was cut down. A lot of clearing had to be done. But and the family now goes out and keeps the inside of the graveyard pretty good.
The nice thing is once you get it tamed, then some of the older people can, the family can help it out.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Next.
And that's a picture that Nancy sent to me showing us the whole, her cousins. That's a cousin's picture.
Really?
Yeah. Picture in the graveyard.
Nice.
Now, unfortunately, shortly after that fence was put up, something happened. We don't know if it got hit by equipment or if some animal got in. Somehow that fence got bowed out in the front. Hmm. And I don't know if that's anything that we're going to ever be able to repair or fix, but it was kind of disappointing to see that because... Yeah, it wasn't cheap to put the fence up.
Yeah, I'm sure about that. The Bitten Bender, is that Hereford?
That's Hereford. Yes.
Because Bitten Bender's hotel is in the village of Hoof's Church.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Oh, I remember talking to Mrs. Bitten Bender years ago who had the store. The store is closed. It was a store and a hotel.
I think we met at Huff's Church when we cleaned it up last time. We meet at Huff's Church.
Okay.
And the
Bitten Bender Hotel was across from the general store. It's an old stone building. I remember when I did a story on Huff's Church, or Hoof's Church, as they told me, the gentleman was so interested in the story that was going to be in the Eagle. And I had a good story with his mentioning him and a picture of the house. And I took it into the Eagle Friday night for publication Wednesday, and he passed away Saturday.
Oh,
gee. Yeah, he never got to see the story.
Yeah.
There were people that were interested in this years ago. I found some old articles. A man named Carl Arner was championing trying to get that done at some point, and I'd love to make contact with him because we wanted to send him the newsletter to show him we did this project because he was in the newspaper more than once talking about how this needs to be fixed.
Let's see. The location of this is really closer to Seashultsville than...
Yeah,
than,
I think I drove by there one time. I'm almost sure I did when I was back there.
That's what it looked like, I guess, when we first went there. There's no gate in the front, but you can see the opening and...
And that was a unique kind of stonework. Our stonemason was just so wowed by that stonework.
Yeah, I'll bet. I'll bet he was.
Yeah.
Thanks.
That's one of our cleanup crews.
Maybe two years ago.
Maybe a little longer than that. But we had, one of the surprising things, we have members and we see their name and they send contributions and that's all we know about them. And we had the first cleanup we did here. Ann puts on our Facebook page that we're having a cleanup there. And we're meeting at in a parking lot in Seashultsville. And somebody pulls in that we don't recognize, know at all. Well, it's a guy with an Italian name from Westchester, who's our member, who is descended from the family. And he saw that he wanted to find where this was. So he showed up on our first cleanup and helped us do the cleanup there.
That's neat that you made that contact.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, they're bad. They're bad. So at some point, you know, we'll try to put them together as best we can. It's not likely they're ever going to stand. Mm-hmm. You know, sometimes we have to make boxes to just put the pieces in and arrange them and protect them.
Over there at Ole, there's that one cemetery that has the stones attached to the inside of the walls.
The Deterk.
Yeah, the old Deterk house, right?
Yep. That's one of my favorites, the Barnett Peter.
Where is this?
That's behind Berks Memorial Garden Cemetery in Maiden Creek Township. And Keith boosted me up on that wall over poison and all kinds of weeds to take that picture.
Nice little obelisk. What can we read it?
Well, Joseph Peter is one of the guys there, I guess. He was a justice of the peace or something in the 1850s. And I guess he sort of towards the end of the people who are buried there. Father is there. His grandfather is also there. And we would think his great-grandfather is there, but we don't really have a tombstone for him.
Back to the Bitten Bender.
Now we're back to the Bitten Bender.
They're out of sequence.
One of the unique features about that, first of all, it's a fairly high wall for a lot of graveyards. And you see that corner there, it's not square, it's angled.
Yeah, and that's unusual.
Keith tries to preserve...
What's that?
Rebuild it the way it was. There's also a heart-shaped stone sort of to the right of that in the wall. And I think that's probably still there because Keith, I'm sure he tried to...
It's a diamond.
A diamond.
Yeah.
A diamond.
He tried to put
it
back. Yeah. By the way, in the woods in the back, like we said, that's Hereford Township. You know, they're mine pits over in the woods over there. We walked around a little bit. They used to do a lot of mining in that area. It's interesting. You have...
At the village of Huff's Church, there are mines all over the place there.
Yeah.
Oh, that's it back in Bittenbender, is it?
That's back to the Barnett Peter.
Oh, the Barnett Peter.
Paul Schumann, who is our treasurer and longtime member, that's his personal adopted project.
Nice.
And he takes good care of
that. Wall looks nice.
Yeah, well, that's another one that Keith rebuilt. At the far end of that wall behind the obelisk, there was, at one point, a tree of about 3 feet diameter.
Wow.
And the whole wall was just sort of, pushed inward, sort of like a V there. And Keith was impressed by the people who originally built that because a wall was still solid.
Wow.
Tree
pushing, but we had it cut down to protect the wall.
That's a handsome obelisk there.
It is.
Yep.
Wow.
So that's what we walked into when we got that cleared out. Somebody had vandalized that.
What? Yeah.
Many years ago, and those were we gathered the stone pieces and we put them on pallets and just stared at them for a while, trying to figure out what we were going to do. And then we started cleaning them using D2, and it took a while to get it done. And then we arranged the pieces. It was a giant puzzle.
I'm sure. We can see that.
Ann and Carla really deserve a lot of credit for this because I thought they were crazy for what they were trying to do. And, you know, like she says, they cleaned the stones. Carla can read German, so she could put things together.
We arranged it like a big puzzle in there, too. And, like, we would find, actually, we'd come back after not working at it for a while and see somebody else put a piece together.
Really?
Yeah. Yeah. I arranged it with the names of what we knew were the transcriptions of the stones and just kind of stuck that there. And people actually contributed to putting the
That's
puzzle together.
And that's what we did with the results then. We had PVC cases made with, what is the cover there? Plexiglass?
Plexiglass, very thick plexiglass.
And we sort of, and so we, the tombstones, as they were rearranged, were put into these cases because they were too broken to repair. And they're just sort of in there as best they can, you know, with pieces out here and there throughout. But that's the best way we can exhibit the tombstones today.
So the cases are really an experiment. Like, my son was, it was then Berks Products, it's now, who bought Berks Products? Who does it? A.D. Moyer is who he works for now. And up in Kutztown, they have a fabrication shop. And I told him what I wanted, and he kind of designed it, and then Darius Strauss in the shop made it. And it cost us a bundle of money, but they seem to be working. And, I mean, they're vented so that the plexiglass isn't making everything all foggy.
Right.
You know, like you see in a lot of times when people have things with glass covered, like you can't see it anyway because it's all foggy. So basically that was a Berks Products fabrication to what we wanted. And we had a few snakes living under them and some cute wildlife, but every now and then we get together and we take the plexiglass off and make sure the stones are arranged all right. And then we had some spots where there were too many gaps in the stones. Like, they just kept shifting. So one of our members, Sean Brown, who is now deceased, came up with the idea to use air dry clay. So we went and took air dry clay and just made hunks to fill in the spots where we were missing the pieces. And that's been working.
You live and learn. Hoch die Tert Schenkel.
That's an Ole.
Oh.
Off of 662.
Yeah, on the, off the right hand
side.
Yeah.
And that's what it looked like when I first got there.
Photo by Kevin Cannon, who has been taking care of the grounds for the last several years. Yeah.
So he has that actually looking like a golf course.
Nice.
He did a fabulous job on that. Once we were done finding tombstones that we thought we could recover, and we were pretty sure that we weren't going to have to dig too much anymore, you know, he started working on the grounds. And he got that really pretty picture with the farm in the background.
That is nice. Breitenstein. And that's located where?
In Flying Hills. Actually, across from Flying, across Route 10 from Flying Hills. In the woods, hidden away. And you see the white tombstones have been treated.
Yeah.
That is a dry stone wall. Affair. We years ago had Keith put together the front wall, but we haven't done either the side or the rear walls.
They're huge rocks.
It's sort of in the woods, a little difficult to get at and work. We've talked about doing more there, but to this point we haven't.
It's a daunting job. I mean, consider how many burials there are and how many cemeteries there are.
It is. And that was a motley work crew, huh?
Yeah. Earlier this year.
It was raining that day. I got there just in time to take their pictures.
And that's a picture from, I don't know, years ago from an earlier cleanup. You can see, and apparently it was after Keith rebuilt the front walls, because you can see the entrance there, and mm-hmm. the walls to the side are looking pretty good. You sort of have to go up a hill to get there through, and fortunately it's the guy who owns the land, I don't know how many acres he's got, but he's got a good size property there. So he cuts the grass, and he does more or less cut a path up to the entrance to the graveyard. But generally when we've been there, the brush to the side is very high and growing out over the path that he cut. So we still have to sort of work our way in there.
And this is a good sized cemetery.
And there was no standardization in the way people's names were spelled.
It's like in the Rife Cemetery over there at Old State Road in Ole. Mm-hmm. Husband is R-E-I-F-F and his wife is R-E-I-F.
Right.
That's the famous cemetery where the snake was supposedly haunting the thing for years and years and years. The snake of the Rife Cemetery.
Well, there were no snakes when we were there.
Yeah.
BCAGP publishes a newsletter written by members, which is mailed twice a year to members. We also do two internet-only volumes as well that can be accessed on our website. And there's the website, www.bcagp.org. The frequency of the publications may change in the future, but at this time we do for a year. Now, again, how much is the dues? $15, you said?
$15 for a single, $25 for a family.
Okay.
And we have some, you know, businesses give us $35, businesses or organizations.
So for some of the older people who just aren't physically capable of getting in there and cutting down weeds and picking up tombstones, I'm sure that you would welcome any kind of a donation to help the process along. Because those walls or whatever, that rebuilding, that's expensive stuff.
It is. Yeah.
That's expensive stuff.
Well, I mean, and we're fortunate right now. I mean, like, going back years ago, Jackie Nine, who was the founder of our group, had a trust created in her will that funds us. Now, that money is going down, first of all. For the last 10 years, you haven't gotten anything in interest, so there was nothing being added to it, basically. And they've been giving us money year after year. So, you know, they're encouraging us to watch how we spend money because they, you know, they see the end of their ability to fund us. But we've sort of taken the approach that if we have the money, we might as well spend it. You know, repair the walls now.
Well, you repair the wall, it'd be good for another 100 years.
So the newsletter that you're looking at, that was our July from this year. And at the top is the picture of the Ole High School kids from Day of Caring. They go out with us once a year, and we do, how many did we do, 20?
About 20 graveyards.
Really?
20 graveyards in Ole. We get three buses of kids with a teacher/driver, and then we split the kids up. And we just run through Ole and do as many as we can.
Neat.
And it's good for the kids because they're learning about things that they might not have seen before.
And Ole is a very special township. I mean, it's something special about Ole.
And these kids love doing it. If we could take 10 buses, we'd probably get the volunteers because the kids really like coming out with us.
So it's 15 for a person, 25 for a family. And if people just join and to provide some sort of a funding, a contribution, that certainly would help. Because again, you go through these things, you look at those walls, that's expensive stuff.
It is.
Even the fluid that you put on the stones to clean them isn't cheap. Was it $19 or something like a quart?
Oh, yeah. The little spray bottle's like $19.
I think $40 for a gallon.
Yeah.
About, I don't know.
I think I have that on one of the coming up slides. But yeah, Ole High School's amazing with Day of Caring. I mean, then we take them to lunch. We take them to the pizza place for lunch, and then we figure out which ones we didn't get to when we redivide them. But those kids work. I mean, they bring their own equipment. We don't have to string their things and fill their weed eaters with gas. I mean, they do all that themselves.
Yeah, $19 a quart. Oh.
And nobody close by sells it. The closest place to get it would be Limeworks in Telford. But you can get it online. And
I see there's an address there and a phone number.
Right, for Limeworks. And it's not really that far. I mean, if somebody's going to get a lot to do a cemetery, you want to drive and not pay the shipping because it's really not that far. But we usually get the 5-gallon container, and then I pot it into spray bottles, and we share amongst who needs to do it. And then we try to keep track of which ones we sprayed because we want to make sure we get back the second time.
Yeah, I'd give it a second shot.
You know.
Now, what's the post office box, did you say, at 19606?
Yes.
3707.
And you have your website.
Mm-hmm.
And you're on?
Facebook.
You're on Facebook. Okay.
Lots of pictures on Facebook.
Well, you know what? And the newsletter has lots of wonderful mm-hmm. pictures in it. That's a great newsletter.
Yeah.
And they're all on our website. You can get, right. how far back? We're back to like the original one. I think they're all on there from 98.
I mean, it's...
From 98, really.
Yeah.
I mean, when Ann started doing the newsletter, though, it improved dramatically.
And, it's handsome.
And we're... The website has colored pictures, or what we mail out is black and white, so it's really much better to look at what's on the website.
On the website.
I mean, it's far from professional. So luckily we have Carla, who does all my proofreading and, you know, finds all my mistakes and puts commas in because I write like I talk. But, you know, it's enough to give people some information and they can see what we're actually doing.
It's very informative. I value the one with St. Henry's. That story that you have in there, that's well done. I enjoyed reading that. Hit the next one. Oh.
We might be at the end.
Yeah, I think that was
okay,
the
Okay, let me comment about this.
One.
On eBay today, I was informed by someone at the Historical Society that these pictures were on eBay for sale. And the sale was about ready to end at the time that I learned that they're going to be there. So I did borrow them to share tonight with the people. That is the balcony at Lowe's Colonial. The picture was labeled Colonial Theater, but from the lifetime of most of us who are watching the show, it was Lowe's Colonial. But look at that, isn't that interesting?
I'm surprised it's that clear.
Yes,
yeah.
Next.
Yeah, you did good.
The Embassy Theater. I remember the Embassy. What impressed me, you know, they had that twinkling sky business. I don't know whether you remember that or not. Yeah, they had that twinkling sky business, and that was such a fabulous theater. Unfortunately, it burned. Next. That was a big theater. I don't know how many. I have it at home, but offhand, I can't mm-hmm. say how many seats there were, but that was quite a theater. Those are splendid photographs. You could tell they were professionally done because the lighting, I remember when I tried to photograph parts of the inside of the Astor before they took it down, that's not easy to get good quality pictures. Next. Undoubtedly, they were taken with an 8x10 view camera. Just look at that. And they were movie palaces. Next. This I remember very well. That business, that cage-like ornate metalwork, that covered the screen. You never ever saw a white screen at Lowe's or the Embassy. They'd start the movie, and as the movie was, as you saw the first images of a film, then the screen opened, and when the movie was over, it closed. You never ever saw a white screen. That was protocol for the fancy theaters of years back. The Embassy Theater. Next. That was the ladies' lounge. I have no recollection of that, whatever. you can look at the styling on that.
The ladies' lounges in those older buildings were amazing.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Next. Okay, something just came to me very recently. My good friend Earl Ibach the historian of Wilmelsdorf, had a box of glass plates. And he said, come and take a look, see what's there. Well, it was a large box of 4x5 glass plates. Most of them were people, Sunday afternoon stuff, not really very interesting. But there was one there that really came out at me, and I thought, wow, this is really something special. I don't know of any photograph that exists that survives, that surely there had to be something at one time, of Charming Forge. At the Charming Forge Mansion, that's a Charming Forge covered bridge, which came down. Dr. Grafe wrote about that in the late 1930s, I think. It says, Topahawken Forge, that thing on the left-hand side was the forge. A forge was essentially an automated blacksmith shop. Whatever a blacksmith could make with a hammer, you could do a whole lot faster and a whole lot better in a forge building. What I read tonight, I went back and checked some of the old Montgomery's history of 1886. They had, at Charming Forge, access to 3,500 acres of hardwood trees.
Wow.
That's a lot of woodland.
Wow, you bet.
3,500. Amazing. It says, originally it was called the Topahawken Forge. It became Charming Forge in like the middle of the 1800s. It says it was erected in 1749 by John George Nickel and Michael Miller as the Topahawken Eisenhammer. Yeah, you know, the big. They had a water wheel, and that water wheel activated a gigantic hammer. And you had to keep your hands out of the way. But now, that was a drawing that was made years ago. That picture originally appeared in the 1923 history of Topahawken, Wilmelsdorf, and they had the 1923 big celebration. I never actually saw a photograph of it. This is the closest thing that anyone has ever had. And yet, when I went through Earl's glass plates, and all of them were exposed in 1897 and 1898. Next. Notice in the background. At home, now I can enlarge. But there you see on the left-hand side, I tried to brighten it a little bit. It's better on the screen than it is here on the laptop. Are the forge buildings. Those are actual photographs. What I want to do is go back and just enlarge the section on the left-hand side of the picture for a better look at the buildings that exist. But that was 1898. And Montgomery said in 1886 that the forge was still being operated. And obviously in 1898, it was still standing. The fact that I know of no other pictures that survive. There had to have been other pictures taken, I would think. But the fact that they don't survive, it's very fortunate to have what you're seeing there in front of you. The next. Oops. Can we go back? How many minutes do we have?
4 minutes.
Four. Can you go back to 51? No, 55.
Yeah. I'm not sure where we're at. Back to photo 51, you're saying?
Yeah.
That could be challenging. Bear with me. I am uncertain.
Now, if we were in an old studio, we'd have a musical interlude on the piano.
If only.
Okay.
There we go. Bear with us for a moment.
Okay, let's see what's 51. No, let's go to 55. Okay, 55. Yeah, 3 minutes yet. Okay. Kissinger Dam. Oops.
What happened there? There we are.
Okay. At the foot of West Douglas Street in Reading, Bear Park is in the 500 block of West Douglas. You continue down West Douglas, although I think maybe part of that road might be closed off lately. But when I was a kid, we lived at 506 West Douglas Street. West Douglas, the very last house on that street. And when I was a kid, mother and I would walk down Douglas to the river. And we'd cross over the railroad track, and then we would be at the river. And then looking to the right was the lock house, the Kissinger lock house. And it would be to the immediate left of what you're seeing on that screen. And that was Kissinger's Dam. It was one of those log dams. And holes had developed over the years, and there was a nasty undertow in there. And when I was a kid, I will not mention the name, but there was a very nasty person who lived on Eisenbrown Street in Reading, and he would go swimming down there, and one day he disappeared. He was sucked into the log cribbing underwater.
Oh, wow.
And he disappeared. And it was a day like today. And I remember he popped out one day, and they called the Schuylkill Fire Company down, and they came to extricate him from his little place, and he burst. My.
Wow.
Yes. So I remember Kissinger Dam extremely well. A lot of kids used to swim there, but it was dangerous because of the holes in the log. The water would pour through there, and it would suck you towards the cribbing. Well, we have a minute left. What's the next picture out of sheer curiosity? Okay, that was being sold on the internet. I couldn't afford the $24,000, so I thought I'd at least show the picture. Isn't that pretty, though?
Yeah.
Beautiful little dog. The chick with the Boston. Yeah, it said estimated 6 to 10,000. Then they turn it on and sell for 28,000. But anyhow, let's see. Is that you? No, that's me. Thanks for watching. We remind you that this program repeats this Sunday at 10, Monday at 9, and next Wednesday at 3 p.m. We return the first Wednesday in September, September the 4th, at 9 p.m. on my birthday.
Very good.
Yes. We thank you for watching.
The Passing Scene is underwritten by Gilbert M. Mancuso, Esquire of Brumbach, Mancuso, and Fagley, P.C.